Welcome to the Madison Miller Podcast. Today is Thursday, May 28th, 2020. Today I'm going to talk about the latest news related to the coronavirus and the latest NBA rumor that's popped around. NASCAR will pick the winner of tonight's race in Charlotte after the race yesterday was postponed due to weather. KBO look back on this morning's games, look ahead to tomorrow morning's games. The celebrity watch party. We will go over tonight's episode, 2013 NBA ReDraft and my 2015 Top 10 Artists. All right, we'll start with the virus. The NBA rumors are out that the league is going to invite 20 teams to its playoff, play-in tournament or whatever they're planning on doing down in Walt Disney World in Orlando. Why 20 teams? They're going to do the 20 teams with the best records. And that includes the 8 playoff teams from the East, the 8 playoff teams from the West, and the 4 teams that were on the bubble in the Western Conference, including the Sacramento Kings, the New Orleans Pelicans, the Portland Trailblazers, and the San Antonio Spurs. Somebody had mentioned to me the other day that they thought that the NBA was going to rig it for Zion Williamson to be in the playoffs. It's not just for Zion Williamson. There's other stars that teams are on the bubble too, like Damian Lillard, who was in favor of the season coming back and then kind of frauded himself and said he was only going to play if it was meaningful for the Blazers. So if they do this 20-team thing, then the Blazers are in it and Damian Lillard would get his wish. I know CJ McCollum was against coming back for the season. That was like one of the known players that was against coming back. Sacramento, you'll see De'Aaron Fox in this tournament, and then the Spurs are back in the postseason essentially again after many thought that this would be the year that they'd fall out. Had not been for COVID-19, I don't think that they would have made the postseason if COVID didn't happen. And then we'd be talking about when's Greg Popovich going to retire and is this over for the Spurs. I think it is over for the Spurs. I do think that they're championship window has closed on its current core after the trading of Kawhi Leonard and the lack of development of young stars there in San Antonio. Although they have some good players there and Popovich is still there. It's like the Patriots right now in the NFL without Tom Brady. They're not really what they were. It's very similar to that. But I think that the Patriots may have a bigger drop-off than what the Spurs saw this season. So, the 20-team plan is certainly a rumor that's out there. I wanted to address that. Just saw across the ticker on TV that the Boston Marathon's been canceled the first time in a long time, in which the Boston Marathon's going to be canceled. There's thoughts that they were going to have it in September, but I think they know something about the NFL season coming back. So that's probably why they didn't do it. Or maybe because they know something about baseball, because normally the Boston Marathon happens and then they have the game in Boston that early afternoon. So maybe they know something that we don't. So I think that's significant that that just came across, that the Boston Marathon is canceled. And then Jeff Passan broke unfortunate news just a couple of minutes ago, is that across baseball, hundreds of minor league players were cut today and lost their jobs. Hundreds more will be released over the next week. And upward of 1,000 players could see their baseball careers end. The minor leagues have simply been devastated. Yeah, this really was something that was hurt a lot by the COVID pandemic, the minor leagues. Hopefully it'll bounce back and be useful for these teams developing their young players. And then Passan follows it up. In normal years, cuts happen, but not like this. The fallout from the coronavirus, expected minor league contraction and the anticipated cancellation of the 2020 minor league season prompted organizations each to release dozens of players who were being paid $400 a week. That is just unfortunate news. Baseball is stuck in limbo. Max Scherzer came out with a very super strong statement last night on Twitter. I'm going to read off what he said. After discussing the latest developments with the rest of the players, there's no reason to engage with MLB in any further compensation reductions. We have previously negotiated a pay cut in the version of portrayed salaries, and there's no justification to accept a second pay cut based upon the current information the union has received. I'm glad to hear other players voicing the same viewpoint and believe MLB's economic strategy would completely change if all documentations were to become public information. So that's strong words from the ace of the Nationals, the reigning world champions, arguably the best pitcher in all of baseball, Max Scherzer, coming out and saying that is strong. I think that this is a wake-up call for the owners, especially one of its biggest stars coming out and publicly speaking like this. A lot of people think that this is the beginning of the end of the inevitable, of some inevitable announcement that the baseball season is going to be canceled. I look at it as a wake-up call, and the players are supposedly going to do their counteroffer by the end of the week, according to Jeff Passan. So we'll see what that is, and that could very well be coming tonight or tomorrow. So that is a huge deal, and if I have more information about this in 24 hours, then I'll talk about it on the show. The Naismith Basketball Hall of Fame for 2020 was postponed to 2021, so you'll have to wait another year to see the late Kobe Bryant, Kevin Garnett, and Tim Duncan be officially inducted into the Hall of Fame with the ceremony. So they'll go in the same year as the 2021 guys, and I'm very interested to see who those guys are. I would probably would think Paul Pierce, because I think he retired in 2017. So these are obviously the guys that retired in 16, Kobe, Duncan, and Garnett, and then next year is probably Paul Pierce, because I think that's the year he retired. So if I had to guess who will be in the 2021 class, I would have to say it is former Boston Celtic great Paul Pierce, and maybe Ray Allen as well. I forgot about Ray Allen, because he stuck around a little longer. Maybe he is already in the Hall of Fame. I really don't remember. I think Ray Allen's already in. So yeah, I think the first name that I thought of for possibly next year for NBA is Paul Pierce. So Pierce and Garnett getting in essentially together is pretty neat for Celtic fans to see. And then obviously you have the late Kobe Bryant, and you have Spurs legend Tim Duncan. The NHL, obviously yesterday they had their big announcement about their return and their plans. There was news that broke that stage 3, which would including going back to training camps, will start no earlier than July 10th. That makes sense. So that would mean that, like, say training camp, it goes on for a few weeks, and then you start playing at the end of the month, like around July, let's say 26th or something like that. And that'd be pretty neat if we got to see hockey back by then. And then the NBA is aiming for around that time as well. And then baseball is just a mess right now, as we previously discussed on the show. Now I'm going to pick a winner for the NASCAR race tonight. It was supposed to be last night, but the race was postponed to tonight due to weather. So I gave out a pick yesterday, and I'm going to roll with the same pick because it doesn't change my opinion on this race. My pick to win this race is Jimmy Johnson. He obviously was disqualified on Sunday due to the failed failed inspection, which disqualified him from the race. He was supposed to finish in second. And I think that he has a chip on his shoulder, and I think that he will win the Allsco Uniforms 500 from Charlotte Motor Speedway in Concord, North Carolina, because Jimmy Johnson owns Charlotte. And I really think that he's going to go out and perform very well. It's unfortunate without fans, but he's going to go out there, perform, and win this race in my opinion, what is his very best track. He's 9-1 on FanDuel, which is ridiculous. Or he was 9-1 on FanDuel. DraftKings 11-1, and BetMGM had it at 14-1, and so did the Bovada out there in Vegas. So, if you can get that 14-1, that's great value on Jimmy Johnson at his best track. Obviously, this is his last year, so I think that he really wants to go out there and win this race in what could be his last race at, in my opinion, his very best track. Now I'm going to go over this morning's KBO results and look ahead to tomorrow morning's games. So without further ado, here we go. SK over Doosan 6-1. NC over Kaiwoom 9-6. Samsung over Lotte 3-1. K2 over Kia 6-5. And LG over Hanwha 3-0. So they change teams and matchups, if I'm not mistaken. KT and Kaiwoom, LG and Kia, Lotte and Doosan, NC and Samsung, and Hanwha and SK are the matchups for tomorrow morning, 5:30 a.m. Eastern Time, which would be 6:30 p.m. out there in Korea. KT and Kaiwoom. I am going to go with Kaiwoom at home. I don't feel strong about it. I think these teams are pretty even. LG and Kia. I'm going to go with LG on the road. I like this LG team. They're playing very well right now. Lotte and Doosan, I gotta go with Doosan. Lotte's really fallen apart lately, and they haven't been the same team as they were early on in the year when they started, I believe, 5-0, so I gotta go with Doosan at home. And CM Samsung, I'm not picking against the Dinos. I refuse to do so until further notice. So I'm going with the Dinos. And Hanwha and SK, like, I gotta keep riding with the Dinos. I gotta keep riding against SK. SK's clearly the worst team in the KBO. And I'm going to ride with Hanwha tonight or tomorrow morning in its match against SK. Now I'm going to go talk about tonight's episode of the Celebrity Watch Party. Fun show on Channel 5. A lot of celebrities watching TV. You would obviously would see reality shows like The Masked Singer and American Idol wasn't on there, but it should have been. Last Dance, you saw a lot of the news. Last week you saw Ultimate Tag. You'll see a lot of that as well. The Graduate Together show, which, all the celebrities, got together and, did a graduation show for the class of 2020. The 2020 Beverly Hills Dog Show, Mission Impossible, Our Planet, Deadliest Catch, and the Masked Singer season finale, and Jesse McCartney was on last week's show because obviously he was unmasked in the finale. So 8:00, you have Tyra Banks, the Osbournes, the Bucks, Curtis Stone, and Lindsay Price. This is the fourth week of it, the one where celebrities watch Friends. So it's going to be interesting to see what shows are on there. I think eventually you'll see game shows on there. Not this episode, but the next episode you'll see them watching the likes of Match Game and Family Feud and Press Your Luck, because that's the Sunday Fun and Games that ABC has together, and the premiere of the new season of that is on Sunday. Who Wants to Be a Millionaire is a show that is not involved in the Watch Party because it's actually on TV at the same time as the Watch Party, but you never know. You'll see a lot of the news and whatnot, and then we'll start talking about Millionaire on tomorrow's show again, because like I just forgot about Millionaire on last week's show, and we'll just catch up with it on the show tomorrow. As tonight you'll see Lauren Lapkus and Anderson Cooper taking the stage in that show. Now I'm going to do my 2013 NBA redraft. This was an interesting redraft to put together. There's a couple big names on top, and then there's a lot of players that never panned out to what we thought they were going to be. Some players that turned out to be borderline all-stars as well. So without further ado, here we go. Number one, Cleveland Cavaliers, Giannis Antetokounmpo. No doubt about it, Giannis, the best player from this draft class. It would have been interesting had they had we known more about Giannis at the time, and maybe, who knows, him on the Cavaliers would have been fun. It would have been him and Kyrie Irving for a year, and then LeBron. Maybe they win more championships there, especially in those last couple years. And they would have been more competitive with the Warriors with Giannis rather than Kevin Love. So that brings a lot of what-ifs with the Cavs there. And instead they took, in my opinion, the biggest bust number one overall pick of the last decade in Anthony Bennett. Number two, the Orlando Magic, Victor Oladipo. No do over here as the Magic take their guy that they initially took in Victor Oladipo. He absolutely has turned into the player that we all thought he was going to be coming out of Indiana. It's unfortunate that the Achilles injury happened to him a couple years ago. And he's rebounded from that. It's unfortunate that this guy got traded multiple times, but once he hit the Pacers, he found his home and really has become the star that we thought he was going to be. It just took a couple destinations because it turned out that Orlando and Oklahoma City did not use him properly. And if they had him now, boy, would their outlook look different. With him and Aaron Gordon, and if Markelle Fultz ever pans out. The Wizards at number three go with Rudy Gobert. Gobert's interesting. You could argue he should have gone second in this redraft, but the Magic already have Nikola Vucevic, and they already had him at the time, so that's why I gave them Oladipo instead of Gobert. So the Wizards take Gobert, and him and Wall and Beal together would have been interesting. It's going to be interesting to see how Gobert, the reception is going to be once fans are back in the seats in the NBA arenas. I have a bad feeling that he is going to get booed. It's unfortunate, but I think opposing teams will boo the living heck out of Gobert. And it's just sad that he happens to be the victim of the first known sports figure to test positive for the virus. And it's unfortunate. Like I said, I think he's going to get immensely booed. I think he's going to get booed just as much as the Astro players are going to be once fans are back in the seats for baseball. Because those fans aren't going to forget, especially Yankee fans, especially Indians fans, and fans in the AL West. So they won't forget about the Astros, just like they it's sad about Gobert, but he just happened to be the victim of the first victim of COVID, and which really made everybody in a hurry to postpone and cancel and pause the seasons of all the sports, and it led to the shutdown of the economy, quite frankly. And instead, the Wizards took Otto Porter Jr. So, like I said, Gobert would have been a great fit with Wall and Beal as the big guy blocking shots, and he's really a foundation piece along with Donovan Mitchell there in Utah. Number four, the Charlotte Bobcats, CJ McCollum. McCollum's interesting. A lot of people were down on McCollum because he played at Lehigh, but he really had his coming out party in college when he led Lehigh to their upset over Duke in 2012, and he had a great game against the best of the best of the conferences in the ACC, and then became a borderline all-star with the Blazers, if not already an all-star, but if he was playing in the Eastern Conference, he'd be an all-star, but he's playing in the West with, which is the conference with a lot of guards that are great. So at worst, CJ McCollum is an above average starter slash borderline all-star. He would have been obviously the go-to guy on Charlotte for sure. And instead they go with Cody Zeller. The Phoenix Suns at number 5 go with Steven Adams. He's also somebody that's a very above average starter, that's a borderline all-star. He really took the starting center job from Oklahoma City and ran once he came into the league. Double-double guy. He's someone that reminds me a lot of Joakim Noah, maybe because of his long hair. But he's a really good player. Really has helped Oklahoma City over the past half decade or so, and would have really helped the Suns. And who knows, maybe they would have traded him and then taken Ayton, or maybe they have him, and who knows, maybe they take Doncic, and then it's Steven Adams, Luka Doncic, and obviously Devin Booker. And Kelly Oubre, too. Wow. But I think the Suns, obviously, that's kind of an L that they took, they passed on Luka. But no offense to DeAndre Ayton, who's a great player, and I think he'll be a star eventually. But yeah, that's just an alternate universe there for Phoenix. And instead, they went with Alex Len, who was a bust. The 76ers at number 6 go with Robert Covington. This is ironic. They draft a guy who they traded for or signed as a free agent after the 2013-14 season. Showed some flashes with the Rockets in his first year and then signed the 4-year deal with Philly. And Covington really came into his own in Philly. Then was a key piece in the Jimmy Butler trade to Minnesota. And then Minnesota got a lot back for Covington when they sent him off to the Rockets. Rocco's the pick for Philly, and he, like Steven Adams and the next couple guys, or not the next couple guys, but I think McCollum and Adams, I qualify as borderline all-stars, and Rocco's just an above-average starter. And then the Sixers in that spot obviously took Nerlens Noel, who was not the player that they thought he was going to be. The Kings at number 7 go with Dennis Schroeder. This is somebody that has turned into a really quality sixth man for the Oklahoma City Thunder. He's a good starter on the Hawks and has thrived in the sixth man role for the Thunder the last couple of years. He certainly would have been a good fit on Sacramento with Boogie Cousins at the time. And instead, the Kings went with Ben McLemore. The Detroit Pistons at number 8 go with Tim Hardaway Jr., a very good starter in the league, drafted by the Knicks. Then the Knicks traded him for a first-round pick when they sent him off to Atlanta. And then he had a career year in Atlanta, had a great playoff. Knicks overpay him. And then the Knicks throw him in the Kristaps Porzingis trade to clear all that cap space. So Tim Hardaway Jr., double-digit scorer per game, good shooter. And certainly would have been a great fit on the Detroit Pistons. And at the time, it was, they were kind of like redoing their team at the time. That was the year that they signed Josh Smith. And maybe it could have been him, Josh Smith, Greg Monroe, and Drummond. And then maybe they do trade Greg Monroe for a point guard or something. So that's a what if for the Pistons. And instead they go with Kentavious Caldwell-Pope. The Jazz at number 9 go with Otto Porter. Porter's interesting, double-digit scorer per game. Was solid on the Wizards, was a starter for them, and then they shipped him off to Chicago in the deal that landed them Bobby Portis and Jabari Parker. That was a bad trade for the Wizards, good trade by the Bulls, and I said it at the time, and it looks like a win for me. Porter on the Jazz would have been interesting. Obviously, at the time, they had Gordon Hayward, and maybe they would have traded Gordon Hayward, or maybe they would have went with the Porter and Hayward wing combo, so that would have been interesting. And instead, Utah went and took, they traded up for Trey Burke. The Portland Trailblazers at number 10 go with Kentavious Caldwell-Pope. With CJ McCollum off the board, they go with Kentavious Caldwell-Pope. The occasional starter and sixth man for the Lakers. Good three-point shooter. He's become a better player on the Lakers. There's a lot of people that hate on KCP because he was a high draft pick that didn't pan out. But he really has turned himself into a quality reserve for the Los Angeles Lakers. And him and Damian Lillard would have been interesting. Although it's obviously not CJ McCollum and Damian Lillard. And at the time, LaMarcus Aldridge, too. And instead, Portland went with, like I said, CJ McCollum. The Sixers at 11 go with Reggie Bullock. Bullock is someone interesting. He's like Kentavious Caldwell-Pope, starter slash reserve. He's on the Knicks right now, or he's going to be a free agent at the end of the year. He'll be a good pickup for a contender. Maybe the Bucks can pick him up or something, but he was on Detroit. Was a solid player for them, and then the Lakers traded for him by giving away Savai Mihaljuk, which I think Detroit will eventually win that deal because I like Mihaljuk a lot. And then obviously now Bullock's not on the Lakers anymore. But Bullock would have been interesting. He probably would have started on Philly at the time because they were obviously not very good. And instead they took Michael Carter-Williams. And by the way, that sixth pick was the pick that was initially the Pelicans' selection, in which they traded along with another first-round pick for Drew Holiday. And that was a good trade for New Orleans. And a lot of people thought that they overpaid at the time. But no, Drew Holiday's been awesome for the Pelicans. I still think he's one of the more underrated players in the NBA. I wonder what year he was drafted. I can't wait to do whatever draft he was in. The Thunder at 12 go with Seth Curry, the brother of Stephen Curry. He's somebody that is a very solid sixth man, occasional starter. He's nowhere near as good as his brother, but he's a solid shooter. He would have been a fine sixth man in that Reggie Jackson slash Dennis Schroeder role in Oklahoma City at the time, and would have been a good sixth man for them right now as well. And instead, they go to Steven Adams, who turned out to be a fine player for them and is still a member of that team. The Boston Celtics at 13 go with Tony Snell. They traded up for this pick. Snell was not the choice here. We'll get into in a minute who they took. Snell, the Bulls drafted him. Occasional starter, mainly a bench guy. Good 3-and-D player. Had some good years with the Bucks. Now he's on the Pistons. And he's somebody that teams like. Solid player. He certainly would have been a good reserve for Boston. And instead, they went with Kelly Olynyk. The Timberwolves at 14 go with Kelly Olynyk. So Kelly Olynyk ends the lottery. Olynyk is somebody that was a reserve for most of his career with the Celtics and now with the Miami Heat. And then he started to start some games for Miami. Double-double capability. Not a bad player. Not a good defensive player, but he's a good offensive player and can rebound a little bit. And it's weird because at the time they had Kevin Love. So maybe him and Kevin Love could have played together, or Olynyk would have come off the bench for them. And then maybe right now he'd help them, whether it's in a bench role or even a starting role next to Karl Anthony Towns, and more likely a bench guy. And instead, the T-Wolves went with Shabazz Muhammad. The Bucks at 15 go with Andre Roberson. It's sad because Giannis was easily the best player in this draft class. And obviously, he's taken one. It's such a sad thing that they drop off from Giannis to Andre Roberson, who's a defense-only type of player. Good player for Oklahoma City. He can guard some of those bigger wings in the league. Someone OKC really likes. Has been injured a lot lately. And at the time, the Bucks had a weird team. They had a lot of weird veterans on the roster. Roberson probably would have been a reserve there. And right now, I think Roberson would have been a reserve too. And like I said, they took Giannis with that spot. The Hawks at 16 go with Cody Zeller. So Cody Zeller falls from 4 to 16. It's funny because I think the Hawks may have had Tyler Zeller at one point. Cody Zeller probably would have been a reserve for them because at the time they had Horford and Millsap. They signed Millsap as a free agent that summer. So Zeller would have been a reserve. And there now, he probably could start for them. Or if they didn't have Capella, he probably would be starting for them right now next to John Collins. That's sort of a what if. And instead, the Hawks went with Lucas Nogueira. The Hawks at 17 go with Mason Plumlee. So back-to-back bigs. So that's just how the draft, the redraft plays out. Maybe they trade Zeller or Plumlee in a package, maybe in a sign-and-trade with the Jazz, so they would land Millsap. That's like a what-if there. So, yeah, there's a lot of what-ifs with this. Maybe they package in a Plumlee in a deal down the road for somebody. So you never know with these things. So Plumlee would have been more likely a reserve. He's a reserve right now in Denver. Was a reserve almost his entire career, with the exception of, I think, when Brook Lopez was hurt in his rookie season. He started for them at the end of the year and helped them in their mini playoff run. And instead, the Hawks go with Dennis Schroeder, who I talked about earlier. The Mavericks, 18, go with Michael Carter-Williams. Carter-Williams was the rookie of the year. He's been bounced around a lot. Right now, he's on Orlando, I think, as a reserve. And I think he would have been a reserve on Dallas, although a good reserve. And instead, Dallas goes with Shane Larkin. 19, the Cavaliers go with Allen Crabbe. So, Allen Crabbe was somebody that had a good run with the Blazers, and then they overpaid him, and then they dumped him on Brooklyn, and now Atlanta has his contract. So, he's just somebody that's like the salary dump piece. Crabbe's a solid player. He would have helped the Cavaliers at the time, so obviously this would have been the LeBron era. And imagine him and Giannis as a draft haul. Oh, my God. Maybe they would have won multiple titles with LeBron back. And who knows? Maybe LeBron's still there, especially if Giannis was on that team. And instead, Cleveland went with Sergei Karasev. The Bulls at number 20 go with Ben McLemore. So McLemore falls from 7 to 20. Solid player. He really reshaped himself as a player with the Rockets as a reserve. Spot starter for them. Good three-point shooter. Just didn't pan out with Sacramento. And who knows, maybe his career would have been different on the Bulls. And instead, the Bulls go with Tony Snell, who I talked about before. 21, the Minnesota Timberwolves go with Dwayne Dedmon. Dedmon's a solid big man. Who knows, maybe that's a trade chip for them down the road in the future Jimmy Butler trade. Or who knows, maybe he's a throw-in in another random trade. So it's kind of like the Hawks getting the two big men, the Timberwolves getting two big men. Maybe they flip one in a trade and they use the other as a reserve, or they keep them both and they end up trading Kevin Love to another team. So there's a lot of what-ifs with this scenario. And with the Hawks, maybe if they draft those two guys, they don't do the sign-and-trade for Paul Millsap, or maybe they do and they include one of those guys. So there's a lot of, like, interesting little what-ifs there. But, yeah, Dedmon's a good player. Bounced around the Spurs, the Hawks. Now he's on Sacramento. And the Timberwolves at 21 went with Gorgui Dieng, who is a solid player. And that's who I have the Nets taking at 22. Gorgui Dieng is someone that had some good years with the Timberwolves, and then they threw him in that trade, that weird three-team trade with the Grizzlies and the Heat that sent Andre Iguodala to Memphis to Miami, along with Jay Crowder and Solomon Hill. Dieng had some good years in Minnesota, and now he's on Memphis as a reserve. I don't know if he's going to be with Memphis that long. I think he deserves an opportunity elsewhere that needs some help at center. Maybe Dallas, if they'll have some depth behind Porzingis. But yeah, Gorgie Dang on Brooklyn would have been fine. Maybe he would have been a above average reserve there in that Mason Plumlee role for a couple years, and then maybe they flip him down the road. And Mason Plumlee was the choice there, ironically. Indiana, 23, goes with James Ennis. James Ennis is someone that's bounced around the league. Good heat check player. Instead, they go with Solomon Hill. Knicks at 24 go with Solomon Hill. With Tim Hardaway Jr. off the board to go with Solomon Hill. Hardaway was a steal for them at 24. If we do, like I said, I have him in the lottery in my redraft. Hill would have been a reserve for the Knicks. They're at the end of the Carmelo Anthony era there. Maybe they would have traded him for something by now. And like I said, the pick was Tim Hardaway Jr. The Clippers at 25 go with Ian Clark. Ian Clark, someone that bounced around the league a little bit, was on that one of the Warriors championship teams as a reserve. He was on the Pelicans as well. I believe he's a free agent right now, and he certainly would have helped the Clippers. Instead, they go with Reggie Bullock, who I talked about earlier. Oklahoma City at 26 goes with Trey Daniels. Good heat check guy off the bench. Combo guard. I remember when he was on the Rockets as a reserve playing minutes for them when they had some injuries at the point guard position. And he really stepped up for them. And who knows, maybe the Thunder would have used Trey Daniels as a trade asset, or maybe they use him as a heat check guy off the bench. And instead they go with Andre Roberson, who I talked about earlier. The Jazz at 27 go with New Orleans Noel, so Noel falls from 6 to 27. Noel in a different situation, maybe he would have thrived. There's the injuries that held him back, and obviously the Sixers as well, because they had him, they had Okafor, and an Embiid, which was weird that they drafted three big men, and two of them were injured when they drafted him, Embiid, and obviously Noel, and they were obviously trying to tank. And now they're a contender, so the process worked out sooner than we thought, and that's mainly because Embiid got healthy, and they lucked out in the Ben Simmons lottery. So Noel and the Jazz would have been interesting. I don't know if it would have been fun like Gobert has, and that's obviously who they took with the 27th pick, and that was absolutely a steal. The Spurs, 28, go with Matthew Dellavedova. Dellavedova was undrafted. He helped the Cavaliers in those runs with LeBron James, and then they wound up trading him to the Bucks, and now, or he signed with the Bucks as a free agent. Now the Cavs have him back as a reserve. Him on the Spurs would have been a lot of fun. That's like your classic Spurs heat check player off the bench right there. And instead, San Antonio went with Levio Juan Charles, who didn't play a game in the league. The Suns at 29 go with Alex Len. That's ironic. In the redraft, they took him 5th overall, and now I have them taking Len 29th. He's still in the league. He's on the Kings right now as a reserve. But maybe they take him in this spot, and who the hell knows? Maybe he's a reserve, or maybe they trade him or something. And instead, the Spurs go with Archie Goodwin. And in 30, the Warriors go with Trey Burke. So Trey Burke falls from 9 to 30. Burke, he checked by. He was not what the Jazz thought he was going to be. He bounced around a little bit. He was on the Knicks. I believe he might have been on the Warriors at one point, if I'm not mistaken, too. So that's a little ironic. He's on Philly right now. And like I said, Burke's somebody that's a heat check guy off the bench for the point guard position. And he would have been a fine backup for Stephen Curry, and instead Golden State went with Nemanja Nedjevic with the 30th pick in that draft, who they wound up getting that pick in a trade. Now I'm going to do my 2015 top 10 artists. This was a fun list to do. These lists are always fun. My honorable mentions, I have a couple of them. Ariana Grande is an honorable mention. She had a good year in 2015. She had a couple moments in that year, performances, and obviously the song that she had that came out that year, which was off the album My Everything the single that she had that came out that year was One Last Time. Selena Gomez is another honorable mention. Obviously a very talented singer. Off her album Revival, she had two singles that came out in the calendar year 2015, Good For You and Same Old Love. And my last honorable mention is Meghan Trainor. She had two singles off her album Title that came out in 2015, Dear Future Husband and Like I'm Gonna Lose You. And now without further ado, my top 10 artists of 2015. 10th place, Sam Hunt. Sam Hunt had a good year. Two of his big singles off the album Montevallo came out that year with House Party and Break Up in a Small Town. 9th place, Ed Sheeran. Ed Sheeran had a good 2015. Two good songs as singles came out from the album X, Bloodstream and Photograph. 8th place, Nicki Minaj. She had a really good 2015. A couple singles off her album The Pink Print came out. Truffle Butter, The Night Is Still Young, and Trini Dem Girls. So, good year for her for songs. In 7th place for top artists of 2015, One Direction. One Direction had a really good year in 2015. Their album Made in the AM came out. Three singles, Drag Me Down, Perfect, and History. 6th place, Luke Bryan. He had a really good 2015. His album Kill the Lights came out, and three singles off that album came out in the calendar year 2015, Kick the Dust Up, Strip It Down, and Home Alone Tonight. 5th place, Maroon 5. Maroon 5 had a good year in 2015. Three singles off the album B, Sugar, The Summer's Gonna Hurt Like a Mother Effer, and Feelings. 4th place, Justin Bieber. He had a really good 2015. His album Purpose came out, and the singles he released in the calendar year 2015 were What Do You Mean, Sorry, Love Yourself. All really, really good songs. And that's when Justin was really coming into his own and growing up as a man when that album came out. 3rd place, Taylor Swift, who had an awesome 2015. Her album 1989 came out in 2014, but she had three singles off the album that year that came on the radio. Style, Bad Blood, and Wildest Dreams, all great songs. And then You Are in Love was another promotion single that came out that year as well, so I had to include that. 2, Drake. Drake had a really good 2015. He had the mixtape, If You're Reading This, It's Too Late, two singles, Preach and Energy, and another mixtape, What a Time to Be Alive, with the song Jumpman. And then Views, his album came out in 2016, but his single Hotline Bling came out in 2015, which was the lead single from that album. And 1 artist slash band of 2015, The Weeknd. The Weeknd had a great year. Beauty Behind the Madness came out in 2015. Four singles off the album, The Hills, Can't Feel My Face, which I think was the best song off that album, In the Night, and Aqua, Acquainted. All right, so that's it for the show today. I'll be back tomorrow recapping the NASCAR race, KBO games from tomorrow, look ahead to the weekend, and we'll pick the weekend's NASCAR races as well. Recap Millionaire and Watch Party, and I'll have my 2013 NHL redraft and my 2015 top 10 albums for you, as well as any other news that related to the coronavirus or just in general in the world in sports and pop culture. Hope you guys have a great day, everyone.